that Jesus was aware of the difficult plight and life and work of the preacher.
Yes, sir.
He knew the sacrifices that the preacher would have to make. He was familiar with the persecutions and the hardships that he would have to encounter. He was cognizant of the envious and begrudgers who would begrudge him, those who would assail him, both the man and the message. Jesus told his preachers in Matthew 10:16, "Behold, I send you forth as sheep in the midst of wolves. Be you therefore wise as serpents and harmless as doves."
Yes, he knew the awesome encumbrance of ministerial encounter.
Jesus knew it all. He experienced it all. The mission of the ministry is one of self-denial. First of all, it is self-denial. It entails the forfeiting of many material possessions sometimes. Leaving familiar territory.
Yeah.
Leaving friends. Leaving loved ones. Making the proclamation of the soul-saving gospel his priority.
Yeah.
First and foremost, that is priority in his life.
Yes, sir.
But too much, too often, the minister is not looked upon as deserving ample consideration and adequate consideration for his labor and his love for the souls of men. But you know, Jesus ordained that they which preach the gospel should live off the gospel.
Amen.
I know we talk about this. We read it, but I wonder sometimes if we really believe it.
Amen.
No matter how you take it, it will make it. Because the Lord spake it. This is not a suggestion, it's an ordination. If we observe verses 7 through 9, it's very reasonable for ministers to expect a living, underscore living, a livelihood out of their labors. If you read verse 8. It is also consistent with the law. But this law was not chiefly given out of God's concern or regard for oxen, but to teach mankind that all due encouragement should be given to those who are laboring for our good. That the laborers should taste of the fruit of that labor.
Yeah.
In verse 10.
Yes,
now the term here, taste, does not mean just a dab of the substance. It doesn't mean just a whiff of the aroma, but it means to be a partaker with those whom he labor. Those who lay down themselves out of their desire and will to do the souls of men good should not have their mouths muzzled. Paul argues from common equity. What they had sown was much better than what they had expected to reap. They had been instruments of conveying to these people the greater spiritual blessings. And after having done so, had they not claimed to share in the material things? What is our observation and reservation? Seeing, they said, that you have gotten so much good from us, yet you grudge to do so little good to us. Paul asked the question, who has so just a claim as I from the church at Corinth, who has labored so much for your good? Paul announced his right rather than by claiming it, he would hinder his success. But he asserted his right lest his self-denial should prove prejudice to the ministry. Now, what I'm saying is, Paul said to the Corinthians, I won't take a thing from you because I don't want to hinder the gospel. And some folk took that and said, preachers should be like Paul. They shouldn't want no money. That ain't what Paul is saying. You missed the lesson there. He argues from the Old Testament establishment. Don't you know that those who work in the temple get their food from the temple? And those who serve at the altar share in what is offered on the altar. Verse 13. He asserts it to be the institution of Christ. In the same way, he says the Lord has commanded that those who preach the gospel should live off the gospel. He told you that the absolute plow should be able to enjoy that which he has worked for. But just as that is so, the preacher also should be able to live from that which he does, that is preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Therefore, it is transgression if an appointment of Christ for anyone to deny or withhold the benefit from the preacher. Y'all missed that. It's a transgression of an appointment by Christ for anyone to deny or withhold the benefit from God's preacher. Y'all hear it in a minute. Now lest I should be long, let me go to this text. Matthew 19, 27 to 29. Then answered Peter and said unto him, behold, we have forsaken all and followed you. Where are we going again? Peter was concerned about what we're going to get. We've forsaken all. In other words, since we have given up our fishing profession, since we've given up the lucrative tax collecting business, we've subjected ourselves in total commitment of the proclamation of your gospel, and what we want to know is that after forfeiting the privilege to secure these things that others enjoy, should we have expectation and anticipation of a reward for making such a sacrifice? You remember on one occasion Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, and he saw two ships standing by the lake. But the fishermen were going out of there, and they were washing up their nets. Jesus got into one of the ships, which belonged to Simon, and he begged him to thrust out a little from the land. Jesus used Simon's boat for his pulpit, and he taught the people. But when he ended his sermon, he told Simon, launch out in the deep and let down your nets for a draught. But if you notice, as the story continues, they took in a multitude of fishes. And there was great astonishment on all of those who beheld. Jesus said to Simon, fear not, for henceforth you're going to catch me. The 11th verse says, and when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. They left their fishing boats. They left their fishing tackle. They left their houses. They left their families and friends. They left their familiar territory. They forsook everything and followed Jesus. So Peter wants to know now, since all our efforts are now concentrated on following you and catching the souls of men for your kingdom, what about our provision and our reward for our families? I think that's a pretty fair question. Well, let's look at Mark's account of this conversation. Listen, if you please. Mark chapter 10, verse 29. Jesus answered and said to them, truly, I say unto you, there is no man that has left house, brethren or sisters or father, a mother, a wife, a children, a lands for my sake and the gospel's sake. But he shall receive an hundredfold now in this time. I wonder if that really meant what it said. But Jesus said, if you give up everything for the kingdom's sake, for my sake, you'll receive in this time 100-fold. Amen. That's in this time. Now, when you get 100, you can't get no more than you. Unless you get 200. Look what it says. You get back now in this time. You get houses. Brethren, sisters, mothers, children, land. But remember now, they come with persecution. And I know that's right. Amen. I know that's no lie. For I really had no ups and my downs. Now, he said, but in the end, you'll get everlasting life. That helps the preacher to hold on. Now, from what direction or from what source do these blessings come? Because God has promised to bless the preacher. Lord, where did it come from? Because sometimes, in some places, look like the place your blessings ought to come from, they don't want to bless you. Well, I'm persuaded that every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and come down from the Father of lights, in whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. There's no doubt in my mind that everlasting life can only be given by God. Well, through what agencies, cometh the material blessings to the preacher or the servant of God. They come through different agencies. Did y'all know that the preacher gets blessings sometimes that don't come from you? Now, I believe that the primary source should be the church. Amen. The Hebrew writer records in Hebrews 13 and 7, remember those who have rule over you, who have spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation. I believe that the primary source ought to be the church. But if you're a preacher and you might be having a hard time, don't give up. God owns everybody and everything. And God got some money and some pockets for you that you don't even know about. Let me share a little of Paul's words, a few of Paul's words to the church at Philippi. Chapter 4, if y'all want to read it sometime, 15 through 19. He said, now you Philippians know also that in the beginning of the gospel, when I departed from Macedonia, no church communicated with me as concerning giving and receiving it, but you only. You don't always have a lot of folk who respond to your needs. He said, but even in Thessalonica, you sent once and again to my necessity. Paul said, I was working for the Thessalonians, but my blessing didn't come from Thessalonica. They came from Philippi. Now because, he said, not because I desire a gift, but I desire fruit that may abound to your account. The minister's concerned about your spiritual growth. He's concerned about your salvation. That's what he's concerned about. And he shouldn't have to worry about the flour and the meal and the meat and so forth that he needs to survive on. He don't need to worry about that. He's concerned about your soul. You're supposed to take care of that business, so he can take care of the business that is most conducive to your good. Amen. He said, but I have all and I abound. I'm full, having received of Epaphroditus the things which were sent from you, an odor of a sweet smell of sacrifice, acceptable, well-pleasing to God. But my God, listen now, whenever you look out for the preacher man, the one who feeds you, gives you the only thing that can save your soul. You can't get this by visiting the White House. I tell you that Obama ain't got that there. You need to see the God man, the preacher. That's who you need to see. He said to them, but my God shall supply all of your needs. Yes, sir, according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. If you take care of the man of God, God said, I'm going to take care of you. Sometimes you wonder why you can't hardly make it.
Yes, sir.
Come on. You work hard as you can, and you make all you can, and look up when you get through, you still ain't got nothing hard to put up. Somebody ought to say something. Amen. Amen. I charge you, Paul told to me. Therefore, before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in the kingdom, preach the word.
Yeah.
No matter what comes or go, the preacher got to preach the word.
Amen.
It ain't always easy. No, sir, it's not always easy. You see, what people don't realize sometimes is that, you know, when church is out on Sunday, see, some of us, and I don't mean no harm, I ain't trying to bother nobody either, but some folk, we don't get to church till late. And we get in church and get a few words, piece of bread and a little juice, and the prayers of some of the saints, and we go on home and don't even think about church until somebody reminds us next Sunday. Preach can't do that. He can't just preach and go home and lay down and rest. When he got through preaching it, on his mind is, where were the folk who supposed to have been here?
Amen.
Yes, sir.
Why we don't have sufficiency to do what we need to do in the Lord's treasury? Why are folk bickering and fussing and fighting and crossing their eyes and rolling their eyes? What's wrong with the folk? All this stuff is on his mind and on his heart. Now, if he got to work with all that stuff,
amen,
he going to wonder why that brother, God has blessed him so much, and he can't show up in fellowship but once a month.
Oh,
all this stuff on his mind. You go home, you go home to sleep.
Yeah. Amen.
The preacher doesn't need to worry about that stuff. He doesn't need, the preacher got to worry about that stuff, but he doesn't need to have to worry about his survival. Yeah. Yeah. And I'm going to try out. The Bible did say he should live of the gospel.
Yes, sir.
Should live off the gospel. Not barely get by on the gospel.
Amen.
Let me tell y'all something. Jesus is no cheapskate. Some folk think that if you're a preacher, you shouldn't want anything. Jesus is not a cheapskate. You must have read your Bible. Jesus told his first disciples, y'all may wake up, I'm going to give it to you anyway. Jesus told his first disciples, when I send you out, don't you even take two pairs of shoes, don't take two coats, don't take no pocketbook, leave your pocketbook at home, because the folk that you go serve, I'm going to use that pocketbook to take care of you. Like Jesus told him. But today, maybe. All right. Sentimental, what's wrong? God has made a promise to his preachers, and God keeps his promise. Paul told Timothy, I charge you before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead, and his appearing in his kingdom, preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, and exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. Y'all know the passage. The time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. God made that time machine right now.
Amen.
But he told him, you watch in all things and make full proof of your ministry. Watch in everything and make full proof of your ministry. God has given your charge. It doesn't matter how bleak things may be, preach the word. I'm a living witness that God will provide. When it seems like there's no way out, God will provide. Amen. See, and I'm not speaking what I read in somebody's book. I'm speaking what I can write a book on. Amen. God will provide. Amen. Paul said to Timothy, I fought a good fight. I finished my course. I kept the faith. So we still got to give God our best. Because he gave us his best. You see, the patriarchs, the prophets of old, they can testify that the Lord won't let you down. Elijah the prophet can tell you that when you are going through trials and tribulations, when the mind is weak and the body is weak, when the mind gets weary, when you have gone as far as you can go and it seems that there is no way out, just be still and give it to the Lord. Lay down your burdens. Give them all to God. Lay down and take your rest. Because God got angels encamped around you. And when you wake up, bread will be on your table. And water by your side. Directions will be at your convenience if you keep your hand in God's hand. God will give you whatever you need. He promised that. Give God your problem. Preachers, give God your problem. He is a problem solver. He told us, I am with you always. As we use a quote that, I will be with you with that too. But that ain't what he said. He said, I am with you. Not that I'll be with you all tomorrow, but I'm with you right now. I am with you, he said, all the way. So if you got a problem, give it to Jesus. He's a problem solver. If your burdens and your load get too heavy, give it to Jesus. He's a burden bearer. If your mountains get too high, turn it over to Jesus. He's a mountain climber. If your burdens get too low, turn it over to Jesus. He can raise you up out of the valley. If you're hungry, he is the bread of life. If you're thirsty, he's the water of life. If you get lonely, he's a company keeper. If you need a friend, he's a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friend. Jesus has made a great promise to his preachers. And if we preach the word, if we live the life, hold on to Jesus. Somebody next door may not feed you, but God got somebody around the corner who's waiting to give you more than you need. All you got to do is keep your hand in the Lord's hand, and I know he'll make everything all right. He has promised his preachers that God keeps his promise. Peter said, the great apostle Peter, he's not slack concerning his promises, as some men count slackness, but his long suffering to us war, not willing any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Love the preacher, support the preacher.
Amen.
And you know, don't wait for the preacher to ask you for something. You should love him enough to be visionary. Well, don't look at me strange.
Amen. Amen.
true men of God have been taken care of by people who just by observing and seeing their needs, they didn't have to ask them anything. Didn't y'all hear about the prophet Elijah? Mm-hmm. Not me. The prophet Elijah. He lived a good life. He was a good man. He did great things. And he would go through a place and the people would observe him. And the lady observed this man coming through town there, doing God's work. And he didn't ask her for a thing, but you know what she did? She went to her husband. Said, you know, that's a good man there. He come through here all the time. That's a good man there. Say, honey, let's build him a room on the side of our house. And let's furnish it all for him. So when he comes through here, he doesn't have to worry about going to Holiday Inn. He got his room already.
Amen.
He didn't ask her for a thing. God got some angelic beings.
Oh, yes.
Not the heavenly cat, but some down here. God got them stationed to take care of us. I know what I'm talking about, y'all. And when you do that, God will bless you.
Amen.
You can't beat God yet. No matter how hard you try. The more you give, the more he gives to you. Just keep on giving. Because it's really true that you can't beat God there. Thank you for listening to me. Take care of preaching.